morning, ladies and gentlemen. May I request you to quickly get to your seats? Thank you. Just a few housekeeping announcements before we begin. One is we would appreciate very much if you put your phones on silent or actually switch them off, because there's nothing so disturbing as phones ringing, especially when there's a mindful sitting going on as it did yesterday. So appreciate it very much if phones are put on silent or switched off. Also, for every time we would require you to be back in your seats, you would hear a bell being rung, and we'd appreciate again if you would take that bell very seriously and make your way to your seats. You would have seen artworks and poems, etc., in the foyer area. These are all done by Sathipasala students from around the world. During the breaks, you could take some time and just take a look at them if possible. The summit schedule is prominently displayed in the foyer area if you need to find out any information. Otherwise, there are also ushers and officials around who will be able to help you out. The proceedings from yesterday are being live streamed. So if you'd like to inform anyone that the proceedings are being live streamed, it's on the Sathipasala website. The last thing is we would appreciate very much if the speakers for this conference remain well aware of the time. We're running on an extremely tight schedule, and there's a timer screen right here where you can see it. So for your allocated time, it will run backwards and give you an indication as to when you should stop. We really need you to stick to time, if you don't mind, because otherwise we have to either cut into someone else's time or cut into your break time, or basically go on for much longer than intended, which can be a little difficult, however mindful you are. So, ladies and gentlemen, good morning once again. Thank you very, very much for joining us today. For those of you who were here yesterday, I do believe it was a very good start to the Global Mindfulness Summit. We will be beginning our sessions with some speakers coming up and giving you a very good background of what will need to be done further down during the day. But before that, I would like you to please rise and observe a few moments of silence for the Venerable Katukurunda Jnanananda Thera, who passed away recently. Thank you, everyone. So, ladies and gentlemen, once again, your phones on silent, and speakers, please be aware of the time. The timing screen is just where you can see it. And I would like to now introduce to you Professor Sarod Jayasingha.
Venerable clergy, friends, thank you once again for inviting me to make this short presentation on IQ, EQ, SQ, and mindfulness. IQ stands for intelligence quotient, E for emotional, and S for social. I'm coming from a science background, so I will be looking at this and setting the scene, as it were, for the subsequent speakers. My talk will be on three areas. One is the story of IQs, then some of the research work, and then relevance to the Satipasala movement. The story of IQ begins in late 1800s when the French government, like Donald Trump is doing now, wanted to limit the educational avenues available for people who are migrating to towards the cities, towards Paris. So they called upon, they wanted to devise a method that would determine which students who will not learn effectively. And this task was handed over to Binet, Alfred Binet. And he devised a system of questions which he thought would weed out those who cannot benefit from the educational system. And from there arose the idea of a general intelligence, the G factor, which is supposed to predict how good we are. And this progressed, this same initiative progressed, and now you have the Stanford Binet test, that's a more recent one. You have the Wechsler intelligence scale for adults and children, and you have the SAT, which a lot of students do sit. And also, we have our grade 5 scholarship also modeled on a similar assumption, set of assumptions. I'll give you a few examples. You can answer this, you're given 10 seconds. Another one. And you'll notice that the first one relates to mathematical ability, juggling numbers. The second one relates to Argentina. That's, you have to know the word, you have to know a bit of English, and you have to answer that question. And this is related to spatial or visual spatial juggling. If you take those two pieces out on the right, what will be left? So intelligence is in fact an ability to observe or perceive or reason out, that's to deduce information from that information what you get, and to retain as knowledge, to be applied to adapt behaviors within an environment. So you must know about Argentina, the word Argentina, in order to answer that question. Now this was subsequently challenged by a professor in Harvard, Howard Gardner. And he thought that intelligence should have other facets, not the simple mathematical abilities, verbal abilities, and so on, but also several other areas. So it's a potential, a human potential, and it includes body kinesthetics. So whether you are able to follow music, dance to a rhythm, etc. And there were two other areas which are important to us. One is the interpersonal, and the other is intrapersonal intelligence. The interpersonal one is the capacity to understand yourself, self-awareness, and the interpersonal intelligence relates to capacity to understand others and motivate them and so on. And you'll see that these relate very closely to what Daniel Goleman talks of. And you'll have more on that aspect later on in the subsequent presentation. And he spoke of emotional intelligence, and social intelligence. So if you really look at it, you have IQ tests, which are a tiny part of intelligence. But if you really look at intelligence from a holistic view, you have emotional intelligence, you have social intelligence, and you have ecological intelligence. That's the latest book by Goleman, where he talks of sensitivity to the world we live in. So what's the research and relation to mindfulness? If you look at this structure, it shows you the relationship of several factors which determine your IQ score as well as school tests. I'm combining the two. And so you have stress and practice. If you practice for your exams, practice for your IQ test, your scores go up. If your attention is undivided into a test, your test would obviously be better. The general intelligence factor, the G factor, your memory plays a role, and so on. And if you look at the research in relation to mindfulness, there is good research evidence to show that attention is more focused when you do mindfulness. There are research to show that intelligence, or the intelligence test, the performance certainly goes up, and so does your performance in examinations, and also in relation to memory. Over the next few slides, some of these are technical details, but since it's a mixed audience, I think I should show that. These are some of the research papers, and all these are in very prestigious journals where there is peer review, a very strict peer review process. So mindfulness reduces distractions. 3 months of vipassana meditation enhances attention. 4 days of meditation training improves performance on mental tasks. And you'll see these are more related to the G factor, the intelligence part. It improves memory, short-term memory, long-term memory, and also performance in examinations. And the latest published, the hard copy actually was released in February in Lancet Public Health on using mindfulness course for university students in Cambridge, where they found that it reduced the stress of students facing certain assessments. So that's in relation to the IQ, as it were. If you look at EQ and social intelligence, the EI and SI, again, there is good evidence that mindfulness helps in both these. It reduces stress, so you do react less to stressors, you will react less to when a person blames you. It also helps you to be more aware of your surroundings, more aware of your own emotions, and also become more aware of your reactions to stimuli, as well as understand other people's emotions. And this evidence is further reinforced by looking at the electrical activity of the brain, EEG, by looking at the structure of the brain, and people who meditate for long periods do have different brain structures, what we call neuronal plasticity. Certain areas of the brain grow when you meditate, and it depends on the type of meditation you do. And when you look at the blood flow using SPECT scans, you find that during meditation and also after meditation, certain areas of the brain are getting an increased supply of blood, which suggests that that part is more active. So what's the relevance to Satipatthana movement, this research which you find in the literature? One thing is it improves exam marks, reduces distractions, and very important, with a new generation of the digital generation which is now coming into the schools. They have been born with iPads, some of them, and mobile phones, and that's full of distractions. And certainly, mindfulness should be one option we should consider to reduce the digital distractions which we have, or which our children will have. It improves friendship and bonds because it improves your emotional intelligence and social intelligence. It reduces emotional reactions, and they ought to be calmer. And a mindfulness program will also help some of those with mental health problems, even stress or anxieties, etc., due to different circumstances which they are facing. So Satipatthasala will have definite beneficial effects, and what we need are further studies, and I think today or tomorrow there will be a presentation by Dr. Yashasvi, who will give some indication of the impact of Satipatthasala in school children. Second thing is, could we have to, as a group, I think Satipatthasala should ask this question. Should we introduce 10 minutes or so? I've given 10 minutes because Venerable Jamajiva did that for 10 minutes, and some of the evidence is that 10 minutes has a relatively good calming effect. So should we have 10 minutes, just like singing the national anthem in all the schools before they start the schools, of mindfulness, which is probably preferable than having one Wednesday for 1 hour, because that's a large block. Here you have 10 minutes in all the schools, and it's a secular form, and that's where the religious leaders would have to come together and support it. Maybe we should think of a pilot project in a few areas, and in the scientific field you have a thing called randomized trials, where you take, for example, you can take 10 schools which are fairly equal, you divide them randomly into two groups. One group, that's 5, would be given the instructions about mindfulness. The other 5 would be given instructions about doing almost the same thing, maybe standing up and listening to a few songs for 10 minutes in the school, or you can have a control group where you don't do anything. And then you assess before and after. Before mindfulness program of 8 weeks maybe, and after 8 weeks. And you can look at various measurements. School absenteeism, school violence reported by children, by the teachers, what the children feel, and so on. So that's one possibility. Third thing is that we should rethink about the grade 5 scholarship. Should we remove the grade 5 scholarship or include assessments of emotional intelligence or social intelligence? Because you can have questions. Even if you don't give a mark, even if you're not going to give a mark, by merely introducing some of the points which you can bring up about interpersonal relationships, etc., would, I think, be helpful. So in summary, I've taken you through the story of IQ and how intelligence was constructed, and now how the intelligence can be defined in different ways. And it's a broader schema of testing. And there's very good research now to support that mindfulness helps in the different forms of intelligence. And I think Satipatthasala is ideally placed to continue this work. Thank you very much.
Perfect timing. Thank you very much, Professor Jayasingha. He took us through some scientific research, the beginnings of the findings of IQ, and how it all translates into the modern day lifestyles of and bringing in mindfulness into our modern day lifestyle. So thank you very much. Mindfulness for emotional balance is the next subject we will be dealing with, and this is a video by Dr. Daniel Goleman.
This video message is intended for the Global Mindfulness Summit 2018 in Colombo, the first such event in Sri Lanka and perhaps in Asia.
I'd like to share with you my thoughts on how mindfulness can help children better manage their emotions and impulse, and also be more resilient in life generally, no matter what life may bring them. I was in a very impoverished neighborhood in New York City. It's called Spanish Harlem. And I visited a second grade classroom. These are 7-year-olds. And I watched them do something that they practice every day. Before I went, I thought the classroom would be quite chaotic because I heard that more than half the students in that classroom had what are called special needs, everything from attention deficit and hyperactivity to actually being on the autism spectrum. But I was quite surprised to see that everyone was quite calm and focused. These are 7-year-olds. I asked the teacher why that was, and she said, "Well, you'll see." And then they launched into a daily exercise of what they call belly buddies. Each student went one by one to their cubby, got their favorite little stuffed animal, found a place to lie down on the floor, and then watched the animal rise on the in-breath, fall on the out-breath, rise on the in-breath, fall on the out-breath, count 1, 2, 3 on the in-breath, 1, 2, 3 on the out-breath. This is an exercise in mindfulness. And it turns out that this is the key to why those children are so calm and so focused, despite all of the problems they have. When you think about it, mindfulness is a mental fitness exercise. The basic move is you keep your focus on your breath. Your mind's going to wander at some point, but you notice it wandered, and then you bring it back to the breath. This is akin to going to the gym and working out with a weight. Every time you lift that weight, every repetition makes that muscle that much stronger. And with mindfulness, every time you bring your mind back to the focus, you're making the neural circuitry for staying concentrated that much stronger. This is because of what's called neuroplasticity, where the more you work out a particular neural circuit, the more connected it gets, the stronger it gets. And this, though a new idea some 15 or 20 years ago, is now very well established in neuroscience. What you're doing is strengthening a circuit in the prefrontal cortex. The prefrontal cortex is the brain's executive center. And as you must know, the prefrontal cortex develops as children grow. In fact, the behavioral changes you see in children from infancy into childhood and teen years and then to adulthood map exactly what's going on as the brain develops. The brain is the last organ of the human body to become anatomically mature. It reaches that in its mid-20s, which means that childhood offers a very special window of opportunity to help children develop the skills and the brain circuitry that will help them through life. And I think mindfulness is extremely important here. Consider the marshmallow test. This was an experiment done at Stanford University with 4-year-olds in a preschool there. One by one, they're brought into a room and sat down at a small table. A big juicy marshmallow is put on the table, and the experimenter says to the child, "You can have that now if you want, but if you wait till I run an errand and come back, you can have 2 then." And then she leaves the room. This is a situation that challenges any 4-year-old. About a third of them grabbed it and gobbled it down on the spot. Another third waited the endless 7 or 8 minutes, whatever it was, till the experimenter came back and they got 2. The payoff for research came 14 years later as these children were graduating high school, about to go to university. They tracked down and the two groups compared, the ones who grabbed right away and the ones who waited. And they find remarkable differences. For one thing, the kids who grabbed versus the ones who waited didn't get along as well with their peers, still couldn't delay gratification in pursuit of their goals, and this is a direct test of delayed gratification. And interestingly and unexpectedly, out of 1,600 total points on the college entrance exam, they scored 210 points higher. This was amazing, even to the people who make up that exam when I told them about it. There at the Princeton group said, 210 points is as big a spread as we see between children whose parents have an advanced degree and children whose parents have only an elementary school education. It's astounding. But these were all the children of people at Stanford, very high IQ families, faculty, graduate students. So what's going on? I think that what's going on is an orthogonal dimension, something that isn't related to IQ. It's called cognitive control. Cognitive control is a child's ability to manage their impulses and their emotions well. And in a test of the long-term implication of cognitive control done in New Zealand, children were studied in detail between ages 4 to 8, and including, by the way, with a marshmallow test, evaluated on cognitive control, and then tracked down in their 30s. And they found that high cognitive control in childhood predicted better financial success in your 30s, better health, better citizenship. So this is the kind of training that helps children become more resilient, helps them with the vicissitudes of life. I've just finished a book called Altered Traits, in which my colleague, Richard Davidson, a neuroscientist at University of Wisconsin, and I looked at more than 6,000 peer review articles on meditation using very rigorous standards. We boiled them down to the 60 best. And what we found was a rough dose response relationship. So the benefits of mindfulness show up right at the beginning. They include better concentration, better memory, better learning. But the longer you do it, if you do this over years, even 10 minutes a day, 20 minutes a day, you see that the benefits get stronger and stronger and stronger, which is why I think every child should be learning these methods in school as part of the regular routine. After all, this helps children pay better attention, helps them learn better. It helps school fulfill their basic mission. It does something else too. The research shows that people who do mindfulness, including children, are triggered less. When they are triggered by an upset, it's less strong, and they recover more quickly. The operative definition of resilience is how long it takes you to recover from the peak of an upset to normal, to baseline, to calm. And mindfulness helps children do that. So I don't see why we don't teach it to every child.
That was a little further value addition to what Professor Saroj began the day with, more scientific examples of how mindfulness does help. I would now like to invite Ash Sheikh Falil, and on the subject of caring for children with mindfulness.
Respectable members of clergy, religious leaders, honorable guests, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum, may peace be upon you. Let me first thank the organizers of this event for inviting me to speak on this important subject of mindfulness and caring for children. Mindfulness is a major area of discussion in Buddhist studies. Therefore, I would like to take this opportunity to briefly examine the practice of mindfulness from an Islamic perspective before proceeding to talk about mindfulness and caring for children. In the Islamic context, mindfulness is the virtue of muraqabah, a word which is derived from the root meaning to watch, observe, regard attentively. We can see the close etymological and linguistic proximity between mindfulness and muraqaba. As a technical spiritual term, it is defined as the constant awareness of the believer with the conviction that Almighty Allah is all-seeing both the outward and inward states. That is a Muslim in a state of muraqaba is in continuous full knowledge that Allah is aware of him or her, inwardly and outwardly. It is a complete state of vigilance and self-awareness in one's relationship with Allah in heart, mind, and body. This vigilance and self-awareness is not only in relation to Allah, but also extends to the vigilance and self-awareness of one's own self and his relationship with others. The exercise of mindfulness in the Islamic context of muraqaba can help train our minds to become more disciplined and can thereby enhance our regular worship and daily activities in addition to maintaining healthy relationship with people. The basic of muraqaba is our knowledge that Allah is always all watchful over us, and as a consequence, we develop great attention and care for our own actions, thoughts, feelings, and inner state of being. As Allah said, remember that God knows what is in your minds. So be mindful of Him, Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 235. This state is called as ihsan in Islamic tradition. When the Prophet was asked about ihsan, he replied, "It is that you should serve Allah as though you could see Him, for though you cannot see Him, yet He sees you." Sahih Muslim. Once the Prophet said, "Verily, Allah has prescribed ihsan in all things." Al-ihsan in the language means proficiency, perfection, or perfect something and complete it. Then ihsan is achieving the best possible result through the best possible means. It includes mindfulness of all of one's deeds, including its intention or purpose, the means through which is executed. The environment in which those actions are carried out and the broader consequences of such actions. It requires one to be in control of oneself and to be fully connected to one's actions physically, mentally, emotionally, and socially. Now, let us examine how the concept of mindfulness has been exercised in the teachings of Islam to achieve the value of caring for children. I would like to take an example from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this regard. A Muslim is required to pray 5 times a day. This is an advanced form of meditation, bhavanava, involving both the mind and the body. And each prayer is a moment to connect with God in a state of ihsan with the total mindfulness that you are present in front of Him and that He see every one of your actions, thoughts, and intentions. Whenever Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam led the prayer in congregation and he hears a child crying, he used to quicken the prayer so that the mother of the child can leave early. Was it because of a lack of mindfulness in his prayer? No. It was because the concept of ihsan includes the mindfulness of the environment around oneself, including caring for children and their needs. Islam considers children to be of the blessings of the Almighty Allah. Moreover, It entitles them to a great deal of rights, makes the proper upbringing of them a strict obligation on parents, and emphasizes on their care and special attention. To take care of children, providing them basic needs such as food, clothing, shelter, education, security, health, etc., are made compulsory obligations and considered to be the most noble act of charity. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "When you feed yourself, it is a charity. When you feed your children, it is a charity. When you feed your wife, it is a charity. When you feed your servant, it is a charity." Caring for children requires mindfulness of not only their immediate physical needs, but also their emotional and social needs. For example, the story of Prophet Joseph, as narrated in the Quran, teaches how mindfulness in caring for children has been practiced by the prophets. When Prophet Joseph relates his dream to his father, Prophet Jacob, that he dreamt of the sun, the moon, and the planets prostrating in front of him, Prophet Jacob did not dismiss or make fun of his son's dream. Instead, being mindful of children's desire and need to have a vision for his life, he ascribed great value to the dream and advised him to carefully guard it as a secret. Children have the right to play and have leisure. In fact, it is a need for their growth and development. The Quran, through the actions of Prophet Jacob, not only recognizes this need, but also promotes it and guides parents and caregivers on how this right should be realized, even when there are risks involved in doing so. The Quran illustrates how Prophet Jacob analyzed the risk and provide advice and guidance to his older children on how they should take care of their youngest siblings. On another occasion, in the same story, when he had to entrust his youngest son to travel to Egypt with his elder brothers, again he judged the risk to the child's safety. And taking past experience into consideration, he makes sure that there is a clear covenant between himself and his older sons, who were the caregivers in that situation, regarding the safety of Benjamin, his youngest son. Mindfulness and caring for children in Islam therefore go beyond being mindful of the immediate factors that can be affect a child, but also of the laws that are needed to protect and care for the well-being and future of children. In the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are many examples of mindfulness in caring for children. In those days, there were no schools or educational centers. The learning tradition was to place the child under the care of learned men for education and learning. Following this tradition, the mother of Anas bin Malik placed her son under the care of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that Anas could also be of service to the Prophet. But demonstrating this mindfulness of the total development of the child, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught him, guided him, and educated him to the extent that Anas became one of the most prominent and learned companions of the Prophet. Once again, caring for children in practice. Caring arises from love and affection. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam loved children greatly. He would allow his grandsons Hassan and Hussein to ride his shoulders even during his prayers. In streets, he would offer salam, this Islamic greeting to children, play and crack jokes with them. Sometimes he would even kiss small children in the street. Once the Prophet kissed his grandson Al-Hasan bin Ali, when Aqra bin Habis, one of his companions who was sitting with him, Aqra said, I have 10 children. I have never kissed one of them. The prophet looked at him. Then he said, the one who does not show mercy will not be shown mercy by God. Now we have examined some of the concept of caring for children with mindfulness in the light of Islam. It is also important to see how its purposes can be best achieved within the teachings of Islam and possibly other great religions. Prayer and act of worship are a great resource and one of the avenues to achieve mindfulness. Mindfulness, by way of spiritual meditation through dhikr or remembrance of Allah, if practiced consistently and regularly, can develop mindfulness. In Islam, state of mindfulness extends deeper to include not only the self, but also the entire creations. This is the quality or state of being conscious or aware of the creations of Allah. For this, knowledge becomes important, since without proper knowledge of a creation, it will be difficult to be conscious about that creation and our interaction with that creation. Extending further, developing a sense of gratitude to Allah for mercifully granting man benefits of whatever Allah has created. Take for example the air we breathe in and out every day. When man is conscious through knowledge, he becomes grateful to the Creator for every breath that he takes. A person who is grateful to the Creator will naturally develop this positive quality to be grateful to man too. On the other hand, it is also important to ensure that the benefits achieved through the practice of mindfulness are well grounded in a value system so that they are not misused or abused. A non-religious approach to mindfulness, produces health and wellness benefits in people's life. It will sharpen the mind, no doubt. But the mind is a tool that can be used for good or evil. As much as they can be used for the good of mankind, mindfulness techniques can be potentially utilized for evil by people not grounded in an ethical worldview. This is where it is important to develop and practice mindfulness within the broader context of religion. Thank you very much, and I wish this gathering every success.
Thank you very much to Ash-Sheikh Faleel. This session especially is bringing in a deeper understanding of the non-religious aspects to mindfulness and how it can be inclusive and empowering to individuals and thereby permeating that to communities. I would now like to invite Father Ivan Pereira to give us his perspective.
Good morning, everybody. Be happy in the moment. That's enough. Each moment is all we need, not more. Brethren, these are the words of Saint Mother Teresa of Calcutta. I am very honored to be in such erudite company, speaking on mindfulness, a topic of great value to society whatever religion, theistic or non-theistic religion, whatever religion one may be adhering to. I say so because in our present context, we are sad to see people in authority and otherwise acting in a mindless or meaningless manner, thereby causing major social problems. The definition of being mindless is to be senseless, to be without purpose, and to lack sensitivity to self and others, and ignore the heights to which one can live, as well as ignore the rights and aspirations of others. That seems to be the attitude of most people in authority, as well as those lower down in the ranks of the social fabric. Unfortunately, that seems to be also the attitude of some of our principals and teachers in our schools, and of course, of some parents and elders who have the responsibility of molding the lives of the young. No wonder one would also observe mindlessness in the life of students in the schools and universities, ragging and harassing of fellow students, the juniors by the seniors, etc. The current guru of mindfulness, Thich Nhat Hanh, suggests that life is found only in the present moment. How true to say that we are generally not in the present moment and our minds are still stuck thinking about past events and thinking about the future and one and what one expects to do and what one expects from others. The lack of attention to the present moment causes a problem to others around us, as we obviously lose focus. Thank you. Mindfulness, by definition, is a simple mental skill training which makes us bring our minds repeatedly to the present moment. However, I am worried about one aspect of the study of mindfulness. To me, mindfulness is a spiritual return to an examination of who we are, especially at the present, and to have a proper appreciation of what is required of us as responsible, intelligent humans. I should not constitute a means for another commercially exploitable notion. I say so because there are many who are tempted to take spirituality and religion out of the study of mindfulness. To me, mindfulness must remain a means of being unified with our Creator, and every thought must be gauged against a proper value system. As representatives of many religions assembled together today, we have all rich traditions which direct our attention to the need to live in the present. As a Catholic priest, I can attest to the fact that many Christians live from day to day, not thinking of what the present should make them think of, but living either in the past or looking to glory and riches in the future. Often they become conscious of the present and what is expected of them as obligations to fulfill in the present as intelligent human beings only in old age, when the only future they can envisage is a life hereafter. Sad, but true. I know we would be treated to and reminded of what other great religions say about the need to be mindful. And so I will try to use the short time available to me to refer to the Christian approach to the subject as I interpret it. Whilst mindfulness is a way of improving our mental state that involves paying close attention to everything that we experience, we practice it intensely in quiet meditation. The Bible is replete with instances where a prophet or even Jesus paused in life to meditate and seek guidance from the Almighty. It is said that Moses, with his trusted friends, spent 6 days together praying before Moses ascended Mount Sinai and spent a further 40 days alone by himself in contemplation before he descended with the Ten Commandments. Jesus, before he began his ministry, is said to have spent 40 days in the desert. And when he was in this weak state, he was tested by the devil himself. Before Jesus suffered his final torture and death on the cross, he prayed by himself in the Garden of Gethsemane. A Christian believes that solitude and meditation bring about the right environment to connect with God. Mindfulness to me means a call to create a space for proper thoughts to enter, and they should inevitably be those which bring you in communion with God. I think all of us know that when we try to free our minds of the mundane and current preoccupations, invariably, soon what rushes in to occupy the space are again similar thoughts which we have perhaps tried to suppress. There are some sects within the Catholic Church, such as the Carmelites, who take a vow of silence. The thinking behind those rigid rules is that those who took the vow should dedicate themselves to prayer and open their minds and hearts to God. Mother Teresa again put the need for prayer this way. She said, I quote, "We should be professionals in prayer. The apostles," meaning the prominent and the closest companions of Jesus, "the apostles understood this very well when they saw that they might be lost in a multitude of works. They decided to give themselves to continual prayer and to the ministry of the word," unquote. The concept of retreats among us Christians, I find, has now been adopted by the corporate world. What it means is that periodically an assessment is made of wherein are we in terms of spirituality and the fulfillment of values, and looking forward to improving one's performance and adherence to the values in the future. Mother Teresa says that our knowledge of self must be clear of the good in us as the bad. The self-knowledge requires a silent reflection, and one could call it mindfulness, as you would eliminate thoughts other than those which tell you where you are at a given time in terms of spirituality. I trust I presented you with a Christian outlook which you would like to think about alongside your own beliefs. Whatever our religious beliefs, we are all pursuing a course which would lead to making our lives better, and also need to think of our lives and the impact it has on society and our loved ones. I wish well for the Satipatthana National Program so that our students with an enhanced skill of mindfulness enjoy improved academic focus, better relationship with peers, empathy, resilience and tolerance in the midst of a lot of stress, which Dr. Thara Dimel indicated to me are the noted findings as results of the Satipatthana program. It is certainly a better practice than corporal punishment or detention of students and the like. I thank you very much for your attention, and God bless you all.
Lots of salient words of wisdom there. Most of all, the concept of mindfulness and how it relates with Christianity, and something we may all remember, which sums up the concept of mindfulness: be happy in the moment, and that is now. Thank you very much, Father Ivan Pereira. My pleasure now to invite Swamiji Darshan.
Venerable and respectful members of the clergy, and my friends in mindfulness, a very warm good morning to all of you. I'm here to talk about mindfulness in relation to transcending religion and ethnicity. Now itself, I would like to tell you, I'm not here to lecture you on mindfulness. There is a mass of information available here on mindfulness. I don't want to add to it, but want to give a few viewpoints from my background. My background is Advaita Vedanta. So let's get on with it. First of all, the purpose, I want to tell you what exactly I'm going to do, and a little glimpse of what is mindfulness as I understand from Advaita standpoint, and the best practice, and then of course I want to conclude. So with regard to the purpose, put it simply, to borrow the English idiom, don't throw the baby with the bathwater. So why I'm saying that is to go beyond the religious and ethnic labels when it comes to mindfulness. I know mindfulness has been promoted by the Buddhist tradition recently. The interesting part is, as human beings, majority of us are averse to religion. So anything related to religion, you call it religious mumbo jumbo. Okay? So, interestingly, even though it comes from the Buddhist tradition, most of the Buddhists will miss it. And what to speak of the other traditions? Because they call it is Buddhist. So everybody will miss it. This is what I meant by do not throw the baby with the bathwater. Don't look at the labels and lose it. So, having talked about it, and also as Reverend Dhammajiva Thera said, it's a single solution to many issues. As he said, panacea. It's a cure for illnesses, and it is also prevention. So let's look at it from that point of view as well. So going into understanding mindfulness, as I understand it, so mindful of what? If you're talking about mindfulness, mindful of what? By the way, you all can nod your heads, answer, so that I know I'm not putting you to sleep. So, being mindful of what thoughts? Whose thoughts are these? Who is producing these thoughts? Who is generating these thoughts? We are generating these thoughts. And amazingly, our capacity to generate thoughts is infinite. Am I right? Anybody who says, I am run out of thoughts, out of stock, come tomorrow. Amazing. So, mindfulness is about being mindful of this fact that it is we who, it's our thought, it's we who produce these thoughts, and our ability to produce these thoughts is infinite. So, being mindful of what we produce and when we produce, being mindful. So far, it's common sense, right? Okay. Let's move on. So then next thing is how this thought process works. Sorry. Something wrong with the images. So I need to do a little bit of extra work. So you see, you have thoughts, and based on the thoughts, you produce action. See, to produce any action, you need thoughts. To demonstrate it, if you want, can anybody raise your hand without thinking that I want to raise my hand? So thought is needed to produce action. So thoughts lead to action. And naturally, actions lead to results. And the results gives us experience. And those experiences, again, feed into thoughts. So this is a vicious cycle. So now, if you go on like this, as I said, infinite number of thoughts, actions, consequences, all of that, we have to face it. And this is where the mindfulness come into. Again, this image is going to let me down. So, anyway, it didn't. Thanks. So, this is where the mindfulness comes into, where we intervene into this vicious cycle. So, when there are our capacity to produce infinite thoughts is there, and we are very busy producing these thoughts, and here we intervene during thinking, using mindfulness and knowledge. So that we can be in control of what we think. Do we need to think? And if so, what we need to think? This is the intervention process. So, this is what mindfulness is all about. Applying the brakes, being conscious of, being aware of what we are thinking, so that we can determine whether we have to think. You see, the number of thoughts we produce for a day has nothing to do with what we do. Most of the time, idle thinking, which will have influence in the future in our actions, undesired influences. So this is where we need to intervene during the thinking process, using mindfulness and knowledge. So, this mindfulness, based on what? Why do we need to be mindful? And from where do we get this desire to be mindful? One is the knowledge, what you receive, what you read about mindfulness. The second one is when we engage in certain actions and when we face the consequences, then we say, I have to be mindful in future so that I don't do these things. So, you become mindful like that. And the third thing is the agitation produced in the mind. Our own thinking produces agitation and we become aware of it and we want to get out of it. So, these are the things which lead to search for mindfulness. So basically, what we've been discussing now is the process how the thinking works. So this is what I said by saying understanding mindfulness, this is the these are the points I want to bring it out. So having understood the mindfulness process or the thinking process, so thinking is the same to everyone, whether you are a Buddhist or a Christian or a Hindu. What you might think is differ, maybe it may differ, but what the thinking process is the same. So mindfulness is all about that. So having understood that, now we need to understand that mindfulness is one of the best practices regardless of regardless of what religion or what ethnicity we belong to. You see, what I would like to highlight here is, see, a good eating habit, exercise is required for healthy body. Similarly, mindfulness is required for healthy mind. So mindfulness is all about the inner workings of our thinking process and how do we control it. Just like learning to control the body, learning to control the mind, learning to focus the mind is all about mindfulness. So it is one of the best practices with regard to a faculty which we possess. Body, we know how to use it. Hopefully, how to feed it, how to get work out of it. Similarly, we need to have an understanding of how to use this tool or faculty which we have called mind. So this is what mindfulness is all about, and it has, whether you are a Christian or a Buddhist or a Muslim or a Hindu, or what ethnicity you belong to, it doesn't matter. Your mind works the same way. Also, I want to highlight, because under the best practices, I want to highlight how it is known as in other faiths, in other thinking also. As I said, I come from Vedantic background. So there we use this, we use these words, consciousness, awareness, inner witness, being in the present, which was used here, being awake, alert, conscious, conscience. These are the words which are used. So all of these, in one way or the other, is referring to mindfulness in different thinkings, thought processes. The same thing is being referred to. So while we are doing the thinking, we also become aware of the thinking, which is known as metacognition, where cognition about cognition or thinking about thinking. So you think of something, what you think of is data. How you think about it, how that process is taking place, that is what is we are talking about here in the mindfulness, so that we can think better, think purposefully, and don't think when we don't need to. Moving on, I want to conclude. So mindfulness is something what we need to have a healthy mind. Just like good food and exercise and all of that is good for a healthy body, mindfulness is required for healthy mind. Otherwise, what will happen is our mind will become full. When the mind is full, then all the other issues, all the disorders, all the modern disorders, stress and all of that, and then they call psychosomatic illnesses and all of that will follow. So you have to decide whether you want to be mindful or you want to be mindful. You know what I mean. Okay? So, healthy mind is required, and mindfulness is the means for healthy mind. And naturally, individuals make a society. So, healthy individuals with healthy mind makes healthy society. And this mindfulness is not limited to just society, but the whole universe itself. One of the pre-summit topics was nature, where mindfulness leads to we taking care of our environment in which we live in. And also, finally, what I would like to say, what I started with, do not throw the baby with the bathwater. So, regardless of what label we use, in religion, language, ethnicity, race, gender, age, etc., please understand, mindfulness transcends all of this. So, what I would like to highlight here is that, as the speakers yesterday highlighted, that this knowledge should be given to young children. Sooner you learn about this mindfulness, more you will become a positive contributor to the society. So, this Sati Pasala is engaged in a very noble endeavor of teaching mindfulness, especially to the young children, school children, which is a wonderful thing. And all of us who have gathered here and the whole nation should support this endeavor, regardless of what labels we have for other interactions. Because these children are our future. Our future, not Christian future, not Buddhist future, not Hindu future, not Islamic future. So we should all of us gather together and support this endeavor so that we can build a healthy nation in which our children can live. I wish the organizers success with regard to this global summit. And I also wish Sati Pasala Foundation all the best. And thank you for inviting me to address you. And lastly, thank all of you for patiently hearing me and nodding your heads, not in sleep. Thank you.
That surely was the ideal summing up for this session, which actually dealt with mindfulness being universal. It is quite ubiquitous, and the very fact that it transcends all man-made boundaries, whether it's religion, ethnicities, color, cultures, nations, it transcends all that. Thank you very much, Swamiji. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now time to present some gifts to our speakers who were in this session. Could I call on Mr. Harsha Gunasena to do the honors, and Professor Sarod Jayasingha. Firstly, could you just make your way up on the stage? Ash Sheikh Falil also, please. Father Ivan Pereira. And Swamiji Darshan. Thank you. Thank you very much for perfectly collating that session, and thank you very much to Mr. Gunasena also. It's time for guided mindfulness sitting now. I'd like to invite the Venerable Yu Dhammajiva to do the honors. Ladies and gentlemen, may I request you once again to please take a look at your mobile phone, ensure that it is either switched off or that it is on silent, and we won't have a repeat of it ringing as it did last evening. Please take a look once again. You could have missed out. So just take your time. Take a look at your mobile phones and please switch it off if possible.
Good morning, dear venerable monks, all the religious leaders and mindful friends. Now it is a good time for sitting meditation. Not like yesterday, and usually the sitting time. So I will just give a guided part just to have an introduction, and I hope everything will be repeating of the same thing what all the good speakers mentioned. We try to develop a relationship, a connectivity to the present moment, and I would add to the present posture. So make yourself comfortable so that your support of the body will be helpful and facilitating the minutes we are going to be mindful. So this is called mindfulness in sitting. So making yourself comfortable, you are the best, and therefore you have to consult the body. We call the body knowledge, and sit comfortably whatever the seat you are going to take. And as I mentioned yesterday, it must be naturally symmetrical, and muscles must be relaxed. So that indicates, just to maintain the posture without any intentions, any will. So at the beginning, we make it well established, well comfortable, symmetrical, and relaxed. So sitting posture, whenever you are taking a lotus posture or half lotus or this Virasana, you are taking a triangular shape and therefore well grounded on the earth, and otherwise you have to take a straight back chair so that your backbone is erect. And in the yoga session with Venerable Yogavachara Rahula, I learned a lesson about the gravity on your chin. Because I am always have that question, whenever meditation is going on, the head tend to bend. So don't let it happen. At least at the outset, make yourself comfortable, and we are going to live with the present moment, going to live with the present posture for about 10 minutes. So today I am going to do without the bell. So at the end of the 10 minutes, I will gong the bell. So as the Daniel Goleman tried to explain, whenever the mind goes out, we call wandering mind, bewildering, you must know exactly where to bring it back. So that is the way our body becomes very salient. Body becomes the pivotal point, reference point, the benchmark. So that I would call a kind of a loving kindness to your posture. So don't worry about the wandering mind as such. It is natural thing, specifically to the beginners. So whenever mind wandered off, if you know, if you happen to know mind is no more at the safe domain, your task or act of mindfulness, I would say, to bring the attention back to your posture. So therefore, the day you are going to start talking about the way back home from the wandering mind to your posture, you are utterly on the spiritual path. And these are the only thought moments we can say very constructive, quite living. It's a non-reactional and unassuming. So therefore, not the problem of wandering mind, what is the capacity for us to come back from this wandered off situation to the present moment, quicker the better, we call it resilience. So whenever we are associating our social members, it's a very good criterion to measure whether he is a spiritual friend or a true man, that is to say, how much time he or she takes to recover. So we are also doing it ourselves. We are going to take time now, make comfortable seat, and don't do as such, but whatever the metabolic function, so non-voluntary activities like breathing, heartbeat, expansion and the contraction of your body and touch of your clothes may be a very good sign to indicate mind is mindful. Or back at home, whenever it goes off, don't struggle with it. Whenever you become aware, then I am no more with the body, with the present moment, make an effort to bring the mind to the present moment. So with that guided instructions, I am going to take time with you. With 10 minutes time, I'll gong the bell again, and that is the end of the sitting session for the morning. Thank you very much for listening. You may please open your eyes slowly at the end of the sitting session. Thank you very much for the participation.